So welcome to lecture 38. Now we'll go to the next complexity in our FEM formulations. We will now consider non-linearity. We have not considered till now non-linearity. So what we had considered till now was, first was simple static case, then we went on to time harmonic case, right? Then we went to coupled cases, coupled circuit field, voltage fed or current fed. Then we also saw, of course, the other complexities like moving mesh in case of rotating machines and all that, but there also we had considered essentially linear case. Now we will see how do we handle non-linearity, and then this formulation can be integrated into any of our earlier formulations, and then we can solve any non-linear problem in two dimensions, right. So now this non-linearity we will handle by well known and very much popular Newton-Raphson technique, which is widely used even in power systems and power system analysis because of its fast convergence. Now let us consider solving Poisson's equation with non-linearity involved. So what we will do at the first instant, we will assume constant permeability in whatever medium, magnetic medium is there. So we will assume constant permeability everywhere in the medium as the initial guess. So then we are actually, this nu is 1 over mu, and then this is our standard Poisson's equation that gets reduced to C times A is equal to Bj after applying FEM discretization procedure. Right. So now what we will do, we will actually get A as C inverse B. Now we are calling this as, we are in the first iteration, and this C matrix is calculated using the initial guess of permeability. Right. So here you have to remember that this C, because finally what is C? Global coefficient matrix is a function of geometry and material properties. Right. So the material property, that is mu, everywhere in that, wherever that magnetic medium is there in the whole domain, there we will be taking, we will be assuming constant permeability, and then we will be calculating C. So, this is the first initial guess for C as well, right. And since we are in the first iteration, we are calling this as A1. That means magnetic vector potentials at each and every point in the domain at first iteration is equal to C inverse Bj, right. Bj comes from the source condition, that is basically J. Okay. Then having got this A in the first iteration, right, then we can calculate magnetic flux density in all elements, right, using this our standard equation which we have seen. If you want to refresh yourself, you can refer this lecture 21, slide number 2, right, is we have seen it earlier more than 2-3 times. So now using this computed flux density, mu in non-linear region can be updated, is it not? So you can update mu. Now how do we update mu? Because we will see that we have to use some function. Mu can be expressed as some function of B. So how do we do that? We will see in a later slide. So mu, since mu is a function of B, and now we have calculated B in each and every element, then mu in each and every element of the non-linear region can be updated. Now in the first guess here, everywhere mu was constant, right? But here, after having got this B, now B in general will be different in different elements. So mu now will be in general different in different finite elements.
For the same magnetic domain.
Is it not? So that is the reason now this mu will have generally different values in different finite elements starting from this calculation, right? Because B in general would be different in different elements. Okay, so now this we can calculate the residue as R stands for residue is in the first iteration, is C in the first iteration. Now this C1 means C with updated values of mu, right, into A1 in the first iteration. So please don't confuse this A1 and this A1, this A1, A2, A3, they are the magnetic vector potentials at the nodes of any element E, whereas this A in the curly bracket is the column vector of magnetic vector potentials at nodes, at the three nodes in the element if you are at the element level, and later on if you are forming the global level equation, then this A will be magnetic vector potential at all the nodes in the problem domain, right. So then what we are doing? Now this residue is simply because now C A minus B with this updated mu, this need not be necessarily 0, because this will not be 0, because depending upon how close you are with respect to the your final mu solution, right, then only this if you are very close to the final solution, then only this residue will come to 0 in that particular element. But in general at the start residue will not be 0, because our we need to refine our guess and we have to iterate number of times, then only our guess will become more and more perfect, and then residue will turn out to be 0. So at the element level, so this, remember this is at the element level, what then we are doing? This C we are splitting into 2, right, we are splitting C into 2 parts. So one is nu 1 times Cl. So nu for this nu is nothing but 1 over permeability, and what we are assuming, the permeability over the whole region is, whole element region is constant. So for every element mu is constant. So for different elements mu will be different, but over one element area mu will be constant. So mu will be constant, and it is representing nonlinearity, right, whereas this Cl, this is the linear part of C, so that is not changing with mu. So we are splitting this capital C into two parts. One is nu, which is nonlinear, and C, which is capital Cl, is linear part, right. Now what we will do? We will consider Taylor series expansion R of R at or R of A plus delta A is equal to R A daba R by daba A into delta A and plus higher order term. Now this is nothing but dissimilar to f of x plus h is equal to f x plus h f dash x, is it not? F of x plus h is equal to f of x plus h f dash x, right, and then this is, if we neglect the higher order term, then only we can stop at this term only. That is what we are doing, neglecting second order and second order and higher order terms and approximating the updated residual to 0, because that is our objective, that residue should be 0, right. So then what we are doing, we are equating this equal to 0, that will give you delta A as minus of daba R by daba A inverse into R. Now again remember this R and A, they are written in curly brackets because it is a column, they are column vectors, and if you are at the element level, this will be R and A both will be 3 by 1, right. A of course is 3 by 1, A1, A2, A3, Similarly, R will be R1, R2, R3, residue at each node, right? And then you have Daba R by Daba A is the Jacobian matrix. Here this should be R and A should be in curly brackets, right? R and A should be in curly brackets like here. So this is Jacobian matrix. So the residual matrix and its Jacobian at the element level can be now written as the following. So this is the Jacobian and this is the residual matrix. Now this residual matrix, this is just a same equation written with all its three components, because as I said earlier, this R is a column vector or column matrix. In the column matrix R1, R2, R3 in the iteration 1 is equal to nu 1, which is 1 over mu in the first iteration. CL is this C11, C12, C13 up to C33. So this is element coefficient matrix and with a superscript L, because this is linear, this is not function of mu, right? And then this A1, A2, A3 minus B1, B2, B3. Now again see, here there is no subscript 1, because this is anyway constant for
the time instant under consideration,
right? So this is constant. If you are solving a static problem, then there is only one value. If you are solving transient nonlinear problem, then at every time instant this will be constant. When you go to the next time instant and do again iterative procedure, then of course this will change, but in one time instant this is going to be constant, right? So that is why
subscripts
are only for this, this and this. And then this this matrix Daba R by Daba A at the first iteration is this, because R is also column vector, A is also column vector. So that is why it is but natural that we will get this has 3 by 3 matrix, Daba R1 by Daba A1, A2 and A3, and then similarly R2 and R3. So this is a 3 by 3 matrix in the first iteration. Now the first element of the Jacobian matrix R1, now we are just expanding this first row, we are rewriting it. So R1 is equal to U1 times this times
element level A vector
minus B1. Now Daba R1 by Daba A1. Now this is only R1, this is not curly bracket, because this is residue at node 1. So Daba R1 by Daba A1 will be simply, so there are two terms here. So first this into derivative of this with respect to A1, which will be simply C11 small l, plus this whole term into derivative of nu with respect to A1, right? So then this as it is, and then this term as it is, and this partial derivative we are splitting it like this. Why we are doing it, we will see shortly. So we are writing it as Daba nu by Daba B square into Daba B square by Daba A1. Right. So nonlinear magnetic characteristic can be approximated as with hysteresis neglected, right? So we can, in one of the approximation you can have it like this, H expressed as some nonlinear function of B, right? And here B square appears. So this whole term is representing nu, that is 1 over, because H is equal to 1 over nu into B, or B by H is equal to nu into B, because B over mu is H, B over mu is H. So this is 1 over mu, or this is nu, okay. So this is nu, 1 over mu is a function of B square. And now why we are taking as a function of B square? because in our FEM formulation, we directly get B square element level when we calculate B, we directly get B square, is it not? So now daba nu by daba B square will be simply this derivative of this nu term, right? And then daba B square by daba A1 will be this, right? Our standard expression of B square, if you recall from our previous slides, and differentiate with respect to A1, you will get it this. Now what we do? Now we will go to the global level. Now these are global level quantities. So we combine element level quantities as we did many times earlier in FEM formulation to get global level quantities. So this correction in A, which will be, you know, now n by 1 column matrix, will be Jacobian inverse, which will be n by n, because this is n by n, into residue column matrix at iteration 1, right? And what is R? R is simply R1 to Rn, residues at various nodes. So the updated values of the nodal potentials can be written as this. So A now add it, because we were till now in iteration number 1. Now we have to go to the next iteration. So A at next iteration will be A in the first iteration plus correction in A that we calculated in the first iteration using the inverse of Jacobian, right. So then we, by this we would have got A in second iteration. Using that, now we can update B, because B square is a function of all A's for any element, right. So we then calculate B. From B we calculate mu, because mu has been expressed as a function of B or B square, is it not? And then using this mu, again we calculate R, again at the element level and then at the global level. So again using the same, because now we have updated this mu 1, right. This is anyway fixed, this is known, this anyway remains fixed for the iteration, for at any time instant, and for all the iterations at any one time instant. If you are solving transient problem, if you are solving static problem, of course then this is always constant, right. And then compute residue vector and continue these iterations till maximum of residue, because there are residues at each of the nodes. So if there are say 1000 nodes, there will be 1000 residues. So maximum of that 1000 values, if it is less than some threshold number which one can set, which can be a very small number. So if maximum of that residue values is less than that threshold value, then you can stop, and then you can say that the convergence has reached, and then we have got the solution. So now what we will do is, we will take one case study, as we have been always doing. After every formulation we do a case study. Now this is coupled circuit field nonlinear transient simulation. Now see, there are three complications here. So we had seen here earlier coupled circuit field voltage fed, is it not, formulation. Then we saw in the previous lecture, we saw transient formulation, and in this lecture now we saw nonlinear formulation. So we are combining now all the three formulations together in this example, wherein transformer, this is a three phase transformer with three phase primary windings. They are excited by some voltage source, they are switched on to voltage source, and then this transformer will draw inrush current, and then we will study the inrush currents in all the three phases. So these windings, primary windings of these three phases are driven by coupled circuit, which is a voltage source and a function of time, that is why it is transient, and it is of course nonlinear because magnetic circuit is nonlinear, right. now we will see the simulation in time. So here now you can see this animated FEM solution by using this coupled circuit field nonlinear transient simulation, that transient formulation that we saw in last three lectures, the present lecture and previous two lectures. We saw all these formulations and the combined code, if you write considering all those complexities, then we can get such time domain simulation results. This is a time domain simulation, time domain, that is why transient as well as nonlinear, because mu is a function of B. And why it is a function of B? Because when the transformer is switched on, the flux density in core can be quite high and can drive the transformer into deep saturation depending upon the residual magnetism and the instant of time switching, right. And you can also see, because of the saturation, you can see here at some instants of time you can see the flux going out of the core, right. So that means flux is coming out of the core depending upon the saturation level, and that also can be very well studied using such simulations. So after seeing that animation of the solution obtained, we will now see the currents in time domain, the currents as a function of time. So you can see here R phase, Y phase and B phase currents marked with different colors. So the R phase current is maximum, because in the simulation we basically excited all the three windings at an instant,
which corresponds to
R phase voltage being 0. That means R phase voltage was at 0, and that is why that switching instant is worse for the R phase and it is not as bad to Y and B phases, right. Because we know from the basic circuit theory that in an RL circuit, and purely we are considering this as a lossless case, we are not considering resistances. So like this we can do transient nonlinear coupled analysis for any electromagnetic device like we saw here for a transformer. Thank you.